I made mention the other evening that the Lord spoke and said that for the next three messages, including this one, so that there would be, we would teach on Pentecost. And so today, this is part one of a three-part series on Pentecost. It was on the Pentecost morning that the prophecy given by Joel some 5 centuries earlier was fulfilled. So let's go to Acts 2, verses 1 through 4. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire, distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance. You know, Luke tells us in the first chapter of Acts that after Jesus was resurrected, that he appeared to many people to show that he was alive, because there were still those who even saw him who thought he was a fake. Jesus is real, and Jesus was resurrected, I will assure you of that. Amen. And he ascended into heaven. We talked about that last week when we talked about the glorious and victorious ascension of Jesus. He then told the disciples, as you remember, to go and wait in Jerusalem for what the Father had promised, which was the outpouring of the Spirit. He didn't tell them how long to wait. And he says to this group, to his disciples, go up in this room. And so they were to go and wait. And through the years, many churches have taught about Pentecost on Acts chapter 2, but we act as if that's the only place that it's talked about. We know from Matthew 5 that Jesus declared he did not come to abolish the Torah or the prophets, but to fulfill them. From the New Living Translation, Matthew 5:17, it says, "Don't misunderstand why I have come. I did not come to abolish the law of Moses or the writings of the prophets. No, I came to accomplish their purpose." So Jesus says up front that he came to fulfill. He came to not to do away with it, but to fulfill it, or as the New Living Translation says, to accomplish the purpose of the law of Moses and the writings of the prophets. So it has to be that Pentecost has roots that go so deep into the Old Testament, because God established patterns, and that's a word we've talked about before. God established patterns in the Old Testament that would help his people understand the fulfillment of the New Testament. Every festival that God commanded the Israelites to observe prophecies of what's to come, it was going to happen and would happen and take place through the Messiah. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 5, 7 through 8. "Clean out the old leaven so that you may be a new lump, just as you are in fact unleavened. For Christ our Passover also has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us celebrate the feast not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." When you and I received Jesus as our Lord and Savior, his precious blood was applied to us. Thank God for the blood of Jesus. And his righteousness automatically was charged to my account and to your account. Passover is fulfilled in us because Jesus came as a guarantee, you know that, of a better covenant, as it's written in Hebrews 7. You can take time to go and read it. So 50 days after Passover, God said to Moses, "Come up to the mountain," and he gave Moses the commandments on tablets of stone. When he did, there are 4 things that happened then and 4 things that happened at Pentecost in Jerusalem. Number one, the cloud of his presence descended on the mountain with a loud noise and fire. Remember, that's the first Pentecost on Mount Sinai. Number two, God wrote the law on tablets. Number three, 3,000 people died that day because they came and touched where they were told not to. And number four, Israel on that day was established as a nation. Now in Jerusalem, on the second literal Pentecost, what happened on the Pentecost in Jerusalem. Number one, the Holy Spirit descended with a loud sound and fire. Number two, God writes the law on our hearts. Number three, 3,000 people were saved.
Hallelujah.
Number four, the church was established. I'm trying to get you to pay attention to patterns. So do you see the parallel, or do you see the pattern? Pentecost was the beginning of something new, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Amen.
So the church was born on Pentecost. But it also was, when it happened, it also was the fulfillment of something very old. Isaiah the prophet, God speaking, said in Isaiah 46, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things which have not been done, saying, my purpose will be accomplished and I will accomplish all my good pleasure. What happened on Pentecost to the 120 people assembled in that upper room changed the course of history forever. It was the next step in the unfolding plan of redemption. What was the first step? Passover. A plan conceived, it was conceived in the heart of God before the world even was created. Look in John 14, 15 through 17. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. I will ask the Father and he will give you another helper that he may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth.
Amen.
Who's going to be with you forever. Whom the world cannot receive because it does not see him or know him, but you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. He's going to be with you and will be in you. Now, those are key words. Now, the Holy Spirit had been with them the entire time that Jesus was there, because you can't separate God. But anyway, he had been with the disciples throughout those 3.5 years that they had walked with God, because God is one, cannot be divided. Since Jesus was with them, the Holy Spirit was also with them. Everybody following me? However, Jesus says, he, the Holy Spirit, will be in you.
Right.
Now, so what is the Lord saying? He's saying a time's coming that the Holy Spirit will no longer simply be with you, but a time is coming that he's going to be in you.
Amen.
So when did it happen that he came in us? You remember, the disciples were not born again. You remember this. During those 3.5 years. Now, people act like they were, but they weren't. Except the last of John. Last of John, we see something. But Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, the whole part of the storytelling, and all the things that the disciples did, they were not born again. Not at that time. So when did they get born again? When did this happen? When did the disciples get born again? John 20, 19 through 22. So when it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and when the doors were shut where the disciples were, this is after the resurrection.
Amen.
For fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, peace be with you. And when he had said this, he showed them both his hands and his side, and the disciples then rejoiced when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Now, let me ask you a question. If the risen Jesus breathed on you and said, receive the Holy Spirit, what do you think you received? You received the Holy Spirit when he breathed on you. And it was at this moment, at this very moment, after the resurrection, that the disciples were born again. Are you with me?
Yes.
So the Holy Spirit had been with them And he is now in them. In other words, they just got saved.
Right. That's right.
Why did Jesus breathe on them? Genesis 2:7. Then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. God breathed on Adam, and Adam came alive. When Jesus breathed on the disciples, they came alive in the spirit. They were born again. Have you been breathed on?
Yes.
Look at Job 33:4. The Spirit of God has made me, and the breath of the Almighty gives me life. Look at Ezekiel 37:5. Thus says the Lord God to these bones. Behold, I will call breath to enter you that you may come to life. You need to move a little bit. I mean, even your bones, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. So at least three times in the Old Testament, we read that the breath of God brings life to people. So there's a pattern here that's established. Jesus followed the pattern.
That's right.
So when he breathed on them, their dead spirits came alive. And the Holy Spirit took up residence inside of them. But what was that all that they needed? Acts chapter 1. So when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know times or epochs which the Father has fixed by his own authority. It goes on. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and as far as the remotest part of the earth. Notice that Jesus said this to them after they were born again. After they were born again. Are you with me? So we're talking about three things. With you, in you, upon you. The Holy Spirit in the Old Testament would come upon the prophets and they would prophesy. But he did not stay upon them. All of these were temporary. But when the Holy Spirit comes upon us, he comes to remain upon us. Now, I'm talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Born again, he's in you. Before you're born again, he's with you. When you're born again, he's with you and in you. Then when you have that baptism of the Holy Spirit, he comes upon you to be with you and to guide you and to give you power, it says. The disciples were born again, and then they needed something else in order to carry out what God wanted them to do and to spread the gospel.
Yes. Yes.
And the Lord said, you tarry and you wait. There's a gift coming from the Father.
Yes.
Something's coming from the Father.
When life goes wrong and the unexpected happens, it often causes us to panic and make unwise decisions. In this 4-CD series, Sandra teaches what to do when panic strikes and how to wake up your faith so you can remain anchored in knowing that God's word is unchangeable. Also included is a book of scripture confessions, which shows the Lord that we are in agreement with him and lets the devil know we will not walk in defeat. Order offer 125, because you don't want to miss the victory God has for you.
Now, it's really sad that all these centuries, and it's very sad, that we have either ignored or did not believe at all that the gift of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, as we call it, that it was from God Almighty. But thank God, 120 years ago, the Lord restored the truth of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And later in the 20th century, caused it to spread to virtually all denominations.
Yes.
All of them.
Uh-huh.
It shook up the church world.
Yes, it did.
Azusa Street, it was teeny tiny.
Mm-hmm.
It was teeny tiny in a warehouse.
Mm-hmm.
They sat on the floor. On boxes on the floor, and the preacher often would put a box on his head. Because he didn't want attention drawn to him.
Amen.
Dr. Seymour, Brother Seymour. It touched the world.
Yes.
The world.
Yes.
More so than any other outpouring other than Pentecost.
Amen.
And it became a mixture of cultures and races.
Yes.
120 years ago. And God flowed, and miracles like you cannot even imagine. You see, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, He wants to use you. Peter couldn't even witness, you got to remember. Before he was spirit-filled, he couldn't even witness to the three people in Caiaphas' courtyard.
Hello.
Hello, church. Then after the Spirit came upon him, wow, 3,000 people came to the Lord.
Amen.
The word power in this verse, you're going to love it. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. It literally means you shall be clothed with dynamite.
Amen.
For the rest of your life.
Amen.
Woohoo! Now, the definition of dynamite is powerful explosives and something exceptionally exciting or wonderful. That's the part I want you to remember, too. Something exceptionally exciting or wonderful.
Amen.
That's what a disciple of the Lord Jesus ought to be.
Amen.
A powerful explosion of godliness.
Amen.
Exceptional, someone exceptionally exciting and supernaturally wonderful.
Amen.
Glory to God. Whoa. But you have to remember that the vast majority of people over the centuries who have been saved never really became a true disciple. A lot of people say they're saved, but have they made any difference in the world for the kingdom of God?
Come on.
Can't tell any difference than them in the world.
Come on.
Than the world. But I want to tell you something. When he thinks you're getting empowered, he's terrified. The devil. He's terrified to think that you're going to be empowered and the Holy Ghost is going to come upon you forever. And you're like a dynamite to be used by God forever. See, when the devil saw what happened in that upper room on that Pentecost morning in 33 AD, he knew he was in trouble. See, he thought, well, at least Jesus is out of here, so I can go up in the ascension. He's gone. But on Pentecost morning, he looked around, and wasn't just one Jesus there. He realized there were thousands. Thousands got born again. What must we do to be saved is what they asked. What must we do to be saved? And he told him, and then the power of God came on. Woo! Dynamite, the whole crowd thought they were drunk. You ever been so excited, so happy that somebody thought you were drunk? I didn't ask if you were drunk and they knew you were drunk. I didn't ask that. I'm talking about you were so excited, God so filled you that you just acted like, whoa, glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, Satan. Jesus in me is bigger than you. And on top of that, I know I read the Bible. You go burn forever. You are defeated. You are defeated. You are defeated. My Jesus has defeated you. I don't have to beat you. You are defeated. Already. Past tense. Over. I know it, and I'm going to act like it. That's what we're talking about.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Men and women filled with the Spirit of God, clothed in the righteousness of Jesus, empowered to do the works of God.
Amen.
Man. John explained it. As he is, so also are we in this world. He didn't say half like him. As he is, so also are we in this world, 1 John 4:17. See, when you and I get excited and believe we are who God knows we are,
Amen.
The devil has a nervous breakdown.
Yeah.
You know, when the power of God came on Peter, James, and John and all those, they were never the same again. But I'll tell you something, Satan was particularly upset when Peter started preaching. You got to remember, he thought he had Peter. He thought he had him. He thought there was no way possible that Peter could get past his denial of Christ. He underestimated the power of forgiveness. If Peter could rise to an occasion like that after he denied him three times, cursed him and denied, and then stand up and preach like he did, all because of the forgiving power of Jesus Christ and the power of the Spirit coming upon him, wow, being born again, made a new person, and he accepted that he was new. He saw that the Holy Spirit would empower disciples to live supernaturally, that he could plant a desire in them to live as Jesus lived and do the works of Jesus.
Right.
Church, you and I have been empowered by the Spirit of God to live like Jesus did, to act like he acted, to speak like he spoke, and to obey how he obeyed. That's the key. Obey like he obeyed. So you have received revelation for the purpose of transformation.
Amen.
In order to be an inspiration. Now all nine gifts of the Spirit listed in 1 Corinthians 12 are available to you, to all of us, everyone who's born again. They're available to you because the Holy Spirit, the giver of these gifts, lives inside of you. Somewhere, many of us got the idea that only certain people get one or another of these gifts, while the rest of us just plod along and don't have anything. That's not true. To say that is to confuse the gifts of the Spirit with the anointing of the Spirit. For example, there are people who are called to prophesy. I mean, called to be prophets in them, but everybody can prophesy. Look at 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 11. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of ministries in the same Lord. There are varieties of effects, but the same God who works all things in all persons. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit. To each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit. and to another the effecting of miracles, to another prophecy, to another distinguishing of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually, just as He would, as God wills, is really what they're saying. So what we need to understand is that the Holy Spirit gave the gifts, and He's the one who operates the gifts.
Amen.
In other words, we put it this way, He's in charge.
Amen.
And any time that the Holy Spirit wants to use you to bless someone else, He will choose the gift He wants you to use to operate and to help that specific person. He's all about helping. The gifts are to help. We do not determine how the Lord is going to use us.
Amen.
That's where the mistake comes in the church. We do not. We don't make it happen. God makes it happen. Our responsibility is to obey the promptings of the Spirit. So let me put it this way. As we close, the admonition and exhortation to us today is threefold. One, understand what God has given you. You are saved and you are empowered.
Amen.
Number two, embrace what God has given you. Don't be timid.
Right.
You've been clothed with dynamite. Number three, when the Spirit prompts you to use one of His gifts, obey Him.
Amen.
Go ahead and terrify the devil. But there has to be order.
That's right.
And always when God does something, it's going to go with the flow.
Right.
You know? Let's take seriously the words of Peter. 1 Peter 4, 10 through 11. God has given each of you a gift from His great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God Himself were speaking through you. Do you have the gift of helping others? Do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. Then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ, and all glory and power to Him will be His forever and ever. Amen.